And we're live. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. We got G Slingo, Nemtol, Quentin in the house. What's going on, fellas? And we also have Gizmo, actually, Patreon. Thank you for that, by the way. Live with us. So we're going to just have a group chat. And if any other Patreon happens to join, that link is in the Patreon link. So you're welcome to come in on that. So Gizmo, what's going on, dude?
What's going on, man? How's it going?
It is going. It is going. It's a Saturday night. It was a pretty good weekend. Phil Smith in the house. What's up? Blimpus, Wade, Anxious, Brian Stewart, Matt Jones, Anthony Quintanilla. What's going on, everyone? Yeah, Saturday night. My daughter graduated middle school Friday.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And then, yes, I was just kind of... What is today? Today's Saturday. Yeah, so that was yesterday. I wanted to do a live show yesterday, but I wound up talking to a good buddy, Jeff Diamond, who owns Diamond Guitars and Diamond Amplification. He got in the way of my live show last night. It was what turned out to be a just, hey, what's going on, Chad? I was on the phone with him till like 2 a.m, just catching up. In fact, I gave him the link. He might be joining us here tonight, and he could tell us what's new and going on over there.
Interesting. Cool.
So Gizmo, what's going on with you? So Gizmo joined us at the PRS event. Yeah. Maybe we'll just start off. I mean, I've been releasing lots of videos on the factory tour. So Gizmo, I'm curious to know from you what you think of, what did you think of the event? What do you think of the videos and everyone else that's in the chat? If you want to chime in, let me know what you think.
Well, first of all, I have to say that the videos are great. The footage that was put out, I think everybody has a lot to look forward to because the stuff that's going to be coming out, it keeps getting better as it's going along. I mean, I think Jack walked us around for what, an hour and a half?
I had an hour. Yeah. About an hour and, about an hour and 30 minutes worth of footage. And I'm trying to keep them in 10 minute chunks.
Yeah. I mean, there's just so much information there. We saw so much. It was really great to see some of the behind the scenes. He opened up some drawers for us, showed us some special stuff, which was nice. The PRS event itself was, I think it was really cool. The highlight, I think, was being able to see that factory kind of like hands on behind the scenes, walking through, unguided, kind of just looking at everything was just really interesting.
So we had the guided tour, which was the day before the event, which was awesome. But the next day, there was the unguided. You could just walk through and touch things, feel things, ask questions about things, which was interesting as well because they had the employees all wearing the red shirts at each station. Just, hey, what do you do here? What do you do there?
And interestingly enough, Jack was even wearing a red shirt, if you noticed, on those days. So yep. The CEO was wearing just a regular shirt walking around, which was great.
Unless you knew who he was, yeah, he would have just seemed like one of the bunch.
Yeah.
Although Paul Reed Smith wasn't wearing the red shirt, was he?
He was the only one without.
Yeah.
I guess he gets that honor being the namesake and all.
I know. That's interesting. It's to have your name on the guitar, there's something to be said. He's the Steve Jobs of PRS, right? So, it's interesting.
He's got his name right on it.
What'd you say?
I said even more so, I would think, because he's got his name right on it.
Yep. But I'll tell you, I've been learning, you know, when you go through the factory tour, it's all happening pretty quick. And then the cell phone's ringing and I'm passing a camera over to you and I'm watching this in detail because he had and there was all that background noise as well. Right. But I'm now doing the playback, listening in detail. There's a lot of really interesting nuggets of information that I'm learning from the factory tour, which is interesting. It's raising a lot of questions.
Yeah. I mean, I've watched, there was so much to process. I've watched those videos probably 2 or 3 times already just because I missed so much as you were saying it because, you know, I start fanboying a little bit and looking around and going, wow, this is really cool. But yes, there's a lot of information in there that's pretty interesting when you listen to what's going on.
Yep. I thought what was interesting, and I'm trying to name each video for those that are curious. JC Smith's in the house. What's up, man? So many people here, 100 logged in right now. And we also have Jason who just joined. Hello, Jason. What's up, buddy?
Hey guys, what's going on?
So Jason, just so you know, you're live right now. in front of a live viewing audience. Just so you know, this wasn't the private Patreon hangout, but I figured I'd open it up to.
Oh, that's fine. I just don't have my camera hooked up.
But okay, no problem. Just letting you know, just up front. So, what was I just saying? I just lost my train of thought. Oh, I'm trying to name each individual video for the thing that I, the piece that I thought was most interesting, like the recession guitar. The S2 is what saved them during the recession.
Yeah.
You know, which I thought was interesting. And I don't know. I actually like the S2. I own two of them. It's funny. I own two CEs and two S2s and no cores.
Out of the S2s and the SEs, which ones are you liking better?
I'm sorry.
And S2.
I don't own any SEs. I used to own a Tremonti SE. I sold it to a buddy of mine. And he loved that guitar, by the way. You know, I guess I have four. If I had to sell two, I guess I'd sell the S2s and keep the CEs just from a collector value perspective.
Yeah.
Both CEs have, no, actually only one CE has birds. So I don't know. I like guitars that, I'm going to speak out of both sides of my mouth now, cause I own Framus guitars, which are very expensive. Right. But I like guitars that I'm not afraid to play, if that makes sense. And no, actually I'm not talking out of both sides of my mouth, because like, if you look at the Phil X guitar, it's about as plain Jane as it comes. I know it's an expensive guitar, but I'm not into, you know, the showy stuff too much. And some of those guitars we saw at Experience, those $10,000-$15,000 guitars.
Awesome.
Awesome. But I don't know if I'd want to play that every day.
Put them up on a wall and look at them. Great. But
it's art. It's like it's art.
Absolutely.
So I'm more, you know, when you look at like, I'm kind of, I like this, I'm not afraid to pick up every day. And if it fell, it would be okay. And you know, it's okay. Right. Which yeah, I kind of like, but some of that $10,000-$15,000 stuff, I don't know. I don't know if that's for me.
No, I'd be too nervous, like you said, that fall over or something, get a nick in it or something. 12 grand a pop, you know, that's
it's a lot of money.
A lot of money.
So Tyler says, who are you talking to? So I have Jason and Gizmo. They are part of the Patreon crew. And Gizmo actually joined me at the Experience event, and I invited them on just to kind of hang out and chat. I don't have a hard agenda tonight outside of, you know, it's Saturday night and I just felt like hanging out a little bit. So get the camera fired up and here we go. So that was about it. And what's nice about having Gizmo and Jason on is it gives me people to talk to instead of just, you know, responding to chat. So we have some interaction. So
I like Phil Smith's comment. He says that's why he likes relics, because if they're already dinged up, it doesn't matter. You just play them.
See, that's interesting. Relic is religion. Some people, you know, it's for some people, it's not for everybody type of thing. What do you guys think about relic? And by the way, Phil, if you want to join this, you're welcome to. You have the link.
Oh,
no, he doesn't have the link. Maybe I should send him the link. So what are your thoughts on relic?
I personally want to relic my own guitars. Right. I just want to play them and whatever happens, happens. And you know, they get beat up. I mean, some of the relics look really great. I just think some of the price points on having a guitar that's already broken and beat up is kind of a little crazy.
Yeah, I don't know.
First relic I fell in love with was that GL56 by George Lynch. It was really nice.
That is a good one.
Hang on, I'm just sending out a...
Yeah, I mean, some of the relics that come out are really great, and they look awesome, and then some are, like, over the top.
Yep.
You know, I think it's one of those things that when you know that guitar has actually been used that much, you know, you look at John Mayer's, you look at Eric Clapton's, and you just see that arm spot's just been worn in and the pick marks and everything else, and you just know that thing's been beat up. I think that looks really cool. I think it loses a little something when you buy it off the shelf like that.
Yeah, I can't say I've ever really saw a relic guitar that I said I wanted to have. I think what interests me most about Relic is how they make it. You know,
I've never seen that process.
Exactly. That's my point. It's and I was talking to the guys at Acacia Guitars one time because they did Relic guitars and they actually have the finish that has the crack lines in the finish. And I'm like, how are you doing that? And they didn't want to tell me.
Oh, trade secrets.
So that's something I'm interested in learning more about. So Stunt Moose says, have I ever relic'd any of my own guitars? I haven't. I wouldn't even know where to start. You know, I don't know.
Well, I can tell you, don't drag it behind a pickup truck. That's the video footage you always look at when you see a relic somewhere. Right.
I don't know. You know, I don't know where I would start. I guess I'd start sanding down the areas that I want a little bit more smooth. Maybe like the forearm area, give it a little sand. Maybe behind the neck area just to get some of the finish off. I don't know. That's probably where I would start. You know, it's all the places that you touch the guitar that you want a little bit more smooth than, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that would be it.
Oh, yeah.
So do you think Relic guitars, you think there's still a big market for Relic guitars?
I think there's a market. I don't know if it's such a big market anymore. I think it's jumped the shark a little bit. It's a little overplayed at this point.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I could be wrong on that, but.
Yeah, I'd agree.
You guys want to hear something? So a viewer that tunes in regularly, he was the same viewer that gave me some information on the Gibson when Gibson filed for bankruptcy. And he actually gave me some really interesting information about the state of the industry. You guys interested in hearing what he had to write?
Sure.
This was in response to the electric guitar is dying, right? It's kind of beating a dead horse. But the question is, what are the facts behind it? Right? Is it dying or sales up or sales down? So he sent me some info, which I thought was really interesting. And for everybody that is curious to know, I'll give you some information that he shared with me. So this is some evidence that the guitar is not dying. The electric guitar is not dying, which is interesting. His notes are really interesting. He said there's approximately 2,000 guitar shows around the world annually, which is interesting. In fact, you know, I always try to relate things to myself. When I started doing this, I went to the Winter NAMM show. Now you have the Winter NAMM, you have the Summer NAMM, you have GitCon, you have Tolman University, you have Experience PRS, and then you have all the local shows like the Dallas Guitar Show. It doesn't seem to end, right?
Right.
Attendance, they're saying attendance at these shows are on the rise, although my personal opinion here, I think some of it gets fudged a little bit. Like NAMM, I don't know how many people know this, but NAMM merged with some technology institute. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Okay.
No. Engineering EIT or something like that. So they combined two things. Not everybody knows that. And then they gave the sum of the numbers and said, hey, attendance is up.
Oh, so they inflated them a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit, right? Because, you know, it's the question everyone asks is NAMM really necessary anymore? Which is, We'll table that question for now. But in the comments, you know, maybe you could answer the question. Do you think NAMM is necessary? I'd be curious to know what you think. Because I just go for the hangout. But if you go for the intended purpose of, you know, you're a buyer and you want to go buy stuff, I don't know how many people need to go there to buy stuff. Because it's a trade show meant for buyers and, you know, vendors, you know, that type of thing, right?
Wago's saying Summer NAMM is dead.
Yeah, I'm not going, but yeah. Okay, so let's see what we have here. Cosmo Fest in Toronto, 12,000 people in 2017. And they're saying this year that 14,000 people registered. Experience PRS, 3,300 people. Winter NAMM, they say attendance was 115,000 people, which is pretty fascinating. When you think about that, in fact, in PRS, Paul Reed Smith said, hey, we're not as big as NAMM, but it's not bad. And when you think about and Gizmo, right, there was a lot of people there.
There was a lot of people there.
So from 3,300.
at NAMM, you also have to consider that there's also, you know, sound and DJing and other stuff there, not just guitar people there too.
Correct.
But PRS, there was a lot of people there.
Yep. By the way, they have Sweetwater Gear Fest. There was, Phil wrote in the comment, there was another big one. Oh, the Shanghai show, which I'd like to go to someday. Let's see what else is in here. Dallas Guitar Festival started out 1978 in a small hotel meeting room, now occupies 140,000 square feet. That's another one. I would have liked to have gone to that one. Sweetwater Gear Fest. I never went there, but I went to Sweetwater. So that kind of filled my, it quenched my thirst for getting the Sweetwater. Following the success of the inaugural South of England Guitar Show in 2016, so on and so forth. So that has to, that specifically speaks to the, 2000 guitar shows annually, attendance is up in the guitar shows. Let's see what else. Growth in Method book sales. Hal Leonard Publishing in 2017 sold more than 555,000 beginner level book methods, wow, which was 5.7 increase, and an additional 170,000 ukulele method books, which is really interesting. I'm not sure where the facts come from, but I don't doubt it. Okay. That's an odd fact to make up, that, you know, 170,000 ukulele method books. This sounds like it was taken from, you know, one of these trade magazines. Okay. The used guitar market survey data, anecdotal evidence suggests conservatively that specialized MI retailers move an additional 1 million used guitars, citing growth in used instrument sales due to both consumer interest, readily available inventory. Oh, here we go. Page 28, Music Trades, July 2018 edition, which, by the way, if you don't get that magazine, you should get it. And it's free if you own a business. Reverb is doubling the size, which actually I just read. Did you hear that? Did you guys hear that?
No, I missed that.
Okay. Reverb is doubling the size. They do $600 million a year.
Yeah, I don't doubt that. Not for 1 second. That's a lot, but yeah.
That's insane. That's like,
think about how rapidly that's grown, that site alone.
That's the size of a sub 1 billion technology company that is, you know, relevant, solving problems, right? Which is fascinating. So they're moving to a 10,000 square foot a building to accommodate the growth of its digital marketplace. That fascinates me because Reverb is what? Just a few years old?
Yep.
Okay, let's see what else. See what else I have on here. Guitar and Accessory Market Association called GAMMA at discoverguitar.com. It's a trade association that promotes greater access to learning and playing the guitar. It's helped 1.2 million people learn the guitar. It's interesting. I never heard of that. I guess I'm not part of the 1.28 million people. Summer NAMM is launching an inaugural event called Future of the Guitar. That's interesting because I had my Future of Gear series. I swear, I feel like people stole the idea from my Future of Gear series that we did. Anyway, little side note there. Curated guitar-focused product collections, blah, blah, blah. Okay, item number three, lies, damn lies, and statistics department. Okay, let's see what we have. Retail sales of electric guitars have finally risen to a level above the 2007 pre-financial crash benchmark numbers, thanks to a 5% rise in shipped units in 2017. Okay. In fact, guitar sales have been realizing a steady year-over-year growth since the financial problems of 2009, and industry statistics indicate that retailers have regained their overall music product sales numbers from that time, a low of $5.8 billion to a new high of $7.4 billion. Let's see number C. There's more numbers here. Top 100 music product suppliers in the U.S. earned 2.4 increase in sales revenue for a combined of $10 billion. Ironically, the combined revenue would have been as high as 6.2% if not for the failing consumer electronics division of, can you guys guess what?
Roland Korg?
Gibson. Of Gibson Brands. Yep. Other stats that people may be interested in, 65% of the $7.4 billion of the music instrument merchandise that flowed through the U.S. retail distribution network in 2017 was manufactured outside of the U.S. Let me say that again. 65% of musical instrument merchandise, MI gear, flowed through the U.S., was manufactured outside of the U.S. Wasn't there something at PRS that I'm vaguely remembering? Maybe it was in one of the interviews, I can't remember, where they said that they've sold more SE guitars than Core guitars since the inception of PRS. Do you remember hearing that?
Yes, there's something around that type of statistic, yes.
Yep, which is interesting.
And they said their top selling SE is what, the Trampas, Zach, I'm drawing a blank on his name.
Zach Myers,
yeah.
Yep. Okay, let's see what else we have here. Okay, looks like the folks are digging the stats. Kevin Kaithen in the house. Dude, what is up, man? Crazy. Okay, let's see what else we have. Retail articles published since Gibson's bankruptcy on May 1st of 2018. We have End of the Guitar, Gibson Bankruptcy Fuels Fear for the Future. That's in The Guardian. Gibson files for bankruptcy and people are falling out of love with guitars. That's from Market Watch. And guitars are getting more popular, so why do we think they're dying? And that's in Rolling Stone magazine. Yeah, Kevin, we need to catch up soon, dude. I'm so happy you're here. It's a surprise, and we should catch up soon. I'm going to give you a call on Monday, dude. So that's all the information I have in terms of what do you think about the stats?
I was going to say, so why do you think there's a perception that guitar is dying? If the numbers are all showing that there's an uprise or at least a steady growth, why do you think there's that perception?
I think because of the article, the Washington Post article.
I think you're right.
You know, that Washington Post article made waves, you know, that the electric guitar is dying. You know, I think there were some useful bits of information that came out of it, but you know, it's a clickbaity title,
yes.
Right? And for those that don't know, when that article came out, this was last year at Summer NAMM, I interviewed George Groon, and he was actually quoted in the article, and he gave me a pretty good interview with Trushak held with his arm was killing him because we didn't plan for the interview and we did it on my iPhone. And but he speaks to that, which is really interesting. So if you really need to know, you know, a guy like George Groon gave a awesome interview and you should check that out. In fact, I'll link it in the description of this video after the video is up and posted and all that stuff. So that's that.
I think part of the other reason of the they say the decline is because I think music has just changed. More pop music, less rock icons, let's say. And you've got a gamut more of an open-ended music scene than just the rock star of the 80s and the 90s.
Yep. It's
I mean, rock stations are kind of dying around the country.
Yeah, I mean, in my humble opinion, I think there is some merit to the rock star changed. What kind of tea? I'm drinking Brisk tonight. Brisk. Cheers, everyone. Yeah, I think the outline of what a rock star looks like has changed, right? We went from, you can't put on 70s music without hearing the predominant instrument, which is the guitar, right? Or 80s, 70s, 80s, early 90s, predominantly guitar.
Right.
And today I think it's a little bit different. When you look at who's holding a guitar today, it's, you know, it's the Taylor Swift, it's the Ed Sheeran, which I commend them. Certainly no dig at all, but it's different. It's changed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think something in Fender stats, I don't remember what the stats were. And this was from my Fender interview from Chuck Levins, which you should also watch because it was just a great interview. He gave me a lot of useful information, but he mentioned about that Fender did their own statistics and they learned that, I think guitar sales were up for female guitarists, right? But interestingly enough, it wasn't in brick and mortar stores. It was online.
Yeah.
You know, which almost begs the question, what are guitar stores doing wrong? And are they doing, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I think part of it is
you have like 5 40-year-old guys hanging out behind the counter.
Right.
Perhaps that's not very inviting for a young girl that wants to learn how to play the electric guitar.
And I think part of the other reason is that the internet is just a thing, you know, we all know that the sales tax thing is finally coming eventually. But I think part of the allure of the online is that you can get it cheaper. You can get it sent right to your house and you don't have to hang out someplace, hunt down someplace. You may or may not find what you want to find. You can just get what you want by a click.
Yep. So Kevin wrote, rock isn't dead yet. Sirius XM Octane is strong with new bands and newer music.
Absolutely. I agree with that. I think XM radio is the highlight of rock and roll music. It's keeping everything alive.
So I dropped my satellite subscription a long time ago. So I'm curious to know, what does everyone think? Is satellite radio still big? Is it not as big as it was when it first came out? Like, where does that stand? That's question number one. Question number two is, why does it seem like, just based on that comment, that all the rock bands are on Sirius, not on some other medium? Why is that?
Well, I can go for both of those. I mean, first, I think that Sirius XM, I don't think that it's just rock bands are on Sirius XM. I think satellite radio just offers such a gamut of music that you can choose from that you can really like anything and be a part of it. I personally don't listen to terrestrial radio anymore. I just listen to, you know, Sirius XM because I know I can get what I want when I want. I go to the channel I want to listen to, whatever genre it is, and there it is.
So let me hit pause for a second. Great Vanzini said, I like streaming, and I have to admit, so do I.
Yep.
I have a Pandora account, which my daughter's telling me I am too old, right? I guess if you're my age, you have a Pandora account, but if you're younger than I am, you have a Spotify account. This is what my daughter is telling me. But that little commentary aside, I like being able to tell Pandora to play, let's say, the Rolling Stones. And the nice thing is Pandora will play that genre of music. So I don't even need to select a button, right? I just play the style of music that I want.
True.
So Taco Party says Pandora's old news, get on Spotify. Someone give me an education here. Why is Pandora old news? And what does Spotify offer me that Pandora doesn't? Help me understand. So Gizmo, do you want to go back to answering the question on satellite radio?
I don't think it matters whether you're on Sirius XM or you're on Spotify or you're on Pandora. I do think that it's the wave of music. I mean, the problem with terrestrial radio is you listen to, you know, 2 songs, 3 songs, and then they go to an hour break of commercials to pay for all that advertising and everything else. It's frustrating. I just want to hear music. And, you know, I think it was Kevin said it. He nailed it. I mean, Octane, you want to hear new rock and roll? You want to hear new metal and stuff like that? That's the place to go because terrestrial radio is just not absorbing it anymore.
You know, Kevin also wrote, he wrote, regular radio is dead, which I agree. My wife wouldn't agree because she listens to 103.5, right? But he wrote, which I find interesting, and I agree. I actually, this is probably where I'm not helping myself. Because when I go to Pandora and say, play the Rolling Stones, it plays all the stuff like Rolling Stones and like Rolling Stones, but I never get to hear anything new. And he wrote, if you turn on Octane, you get to find bands that you wouldn't normally find. And maybe that's interesting because something I struggle with is finding new bands. What are the new bands?
Well,
I can't tell you the last time I heard a song that said, man, I need to go buy that song. Because I only listen to the stuff that I know. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I will. No, I was going to say, I will tell you, driving down to the PRS event, that's all I had on was Octane. And really? When I pulled over to go to a rest stop, I downloaded two songs on the way.
Because you heard on Octane.
Yeah. New stuff.
Huh.
And I mean, that's the great thing with iTunes. I just pulled over, downloaded my iTunes, and then I could listen to them again as I was going down.
Then you find them and add them to Spotify. So, Kevin, why Spotify and not Pandora? Help me out here. So while you're answering that, I'm actually driving down to Maryland on Monday. I'm going to be at Chuck Levin's Monday night. So if you're in the area and want to hang out, I'm going to be shooting a little bit video in Chuck's on Monday night. You're more than welcome to kind of hang out. You're more than welcome to kind of hang out and hold a camera for me if you'd like. But maybe I'll turn satellite on and maybe I'll do that. I got a 3-hour drive. I might actually get Octane now just based on this chat.
Octane and Turbo. It's if you like the hard rock from the 90s and the 2000s, it's all right there.
So Kevin writes, the other issue is how bands are getting paid on Spotify. I like that I could add a specific playlist to Spotify. Interesting. Oh, you can't do that with Pandora. The playlist is the genre of music. Play 80s rock, play Rolling Stones, that type of thing. But that's interesting.
Yeah, but on Pandora, you can add certain bands to it to expand that.
Yeah, maybe I need to figure that out.
Spotify's better with it, but Pandora you can still do that with.
I'm still in the thing of I like owning stuff. Play any song anytime. Interesting.
Yeah. Me too.
You know. That's why I usually use Apple Music. I mean, you know, you hear something, you just look it up right quick, you download it. You pay the subscription fee for the month, and you can download it to your phone or you can stream it, depending on your data plan, so on and so forth. But then again, you run into the same thing you were talking about. New music. Where do you find your new music? So on and so forth.
Yeah, that's the question. Where do you find new music? Okay, so Kevin wrote, and then you could play offline on a plane. But you don't own it, right? If you ever stop Spotify, all that music goes away, right? Interesting. Rebel saying Apple Music is the way to go.
I haven't jumped on that bandwagon yet.
Nah, me neither.
I usually listen to something like Octane and then I'll just download it off iTunes or buy the CD even.
Yep.
No, that's old school.
All right. So the electric guitar isn't dying. And by the way, I have a question to ask. You know, sometimes I don't ask enough questions. Last week when I did my live show, I asked someone, I said, anybody willing to timestamp this video? And I was shocked because someone volunteered. They sent me an email and it was like the whole video was timestamped. So thank you for that. You know, it's like one of those ask and you shall receive. So I was really appreciative of that. So thank you. So there's a couple of other things I'd like to throw out there, which is kind of an ask. One of the things is I'm not going to Summer NAMM. And I'd love to have some video content about Summer NAMM where maybe I could collaborate with somebody that will be at Summer NAMM for the channel. So if you are interested in working with me on capturing some Summer NAMM content for this channel, I would ask you to send me an email and let's talk about it. I think Summer NAMM is next weekend. I won't be there. But if you're going to be there and you have a camera and you dig this sort of thing, send me an email and, maybe we could get something for all of us to see and watch and enjoy. So send me an email and, let me know if you're interested in shooting some video for Summer NAMM. And I could probably get some interviews and some access as well. So that always comes along with it. Kind of like our PRS experience thing, right, Gizmo?
Yeah, no, that's great.
But I don't want to be the weak link in this chain. And it's a full-time, 2,000 guitar shows, right, a year. I would have loved to have gone to Dallas. I would have loved to have gone to Toman. And I'd love to go to Shanghai, but I'm not. I'm going to the GitCon event and so on and so forth. It's to cover these shows, it's like a full-time thing, you know. And let's be real. You don't get paid to go cover these shows. That's why I treat it like, you know, a mini vacation where I walk around instead of taking pictures of scenery, I'm taking pictures of guitars, right? Because you really got to be interested in the sort of things. It doesn't pay much, if anything at all, just to be clear.
Just to bring it up, because somebody brought it up in the chat. Somebody mentioned Vinnie Paul. Vinnie Paul passed on Friday, which is such a loss to music. Just wanted to throw that out there. Pantera, Damage Plan.
Does anyone know what happened? Was he ill or was it sudden?
Didn't hear the facts. Everybody did a memorial, but nobody kind of listed why. Mm.
Yeah.
He was 54, I believe.
Yeah, it's young.
Yeah.
That's young. So here's another question for everyone. Oh, Dan Benker. What's up, Dan? He said he died in his sleep. Wow. Well, you know, thoughts and prayers to his family. That sucks, right? It says dies in his sleep. We have Kenny Loggins logged in. You see that?
Nice.
I didn't know Kenny Loggins was a fan.
Wow.
It would be shocking if it was really Kenny Loggins. That's pretty hilarious.
You get on here and chat.
Yeah. So I have another question for everyone. You know, when I'm not doing... I've slowed down with like the official reviews just because they're so time consuming and I have to be honest with you. They're not a lot of fun to do. Right. You know, I sit down in this chair and I put like an amp on a drum stool and I spend an hour shooting video, an hour editing video. And you know, it's one of those, it's not really that exciting. What is exciting is the getting to plug into gear. Right. And just fiddling around with it. So, and these live shows, of course, which I've been doing more live shows. That's why anytime I review stuff, I do it during the live show now, because at least I get to interact with people. It's a lot more humane than just sitting in here, you know, by yourself, talking to yourself, and then editing you having talked to yourself. So here's my question. I was playing an old 1x12 combo amp, the PV Windsor Studio, and I was just kind of enjoying the sound from the amp. So I asked my son, I'm like, can you hold the iPhone camera and just record? I want to just kind of give a quick 2-3 minute overview of it. And he did. And he did a nice job. And I have the video. I actually uploaded it. I didn't release it yet. And I guess the question is, how bad do you think it would be if I did these quick little cell phone reviews of, hey, this is in the moment, I'm playing this piece of gear, this is what this piece of gear sounds like, and this is why I like this piece of gear. You think that's bad? Like if it's a non-produced spur of the moment thing that I happen to be, you know, jamming on an amp that's not behind me for 5 minutes? What are your thoughts? Gizmo, what do you think? Because I could see the comments coming a mile away. They're like, dude, you recorded this on your cell phone, which is not what I'm trying to accomplish here.
You take it for what it's worth. If I haven't heard that amp before and I want to kind of get a context of what it sounds like, I think a 5-10 minute little clip of like, hey, here's what it is, here's what it sounds like, here's what I think, that's mm-hmm. better than, you know, not being able to hear it or not being able to. Sometimes when something's overproduced, you don't get a sense of what it really sounds like anyway.
Right.
So being able to kind of hear and get the context from you, I know where you're coming from and things like that. It's a refreshing thing to just get a quick little glimpse into what's going on.
So Pedro, thank you for that. And I appreciate that. Pedro said that's what YouTube used to be. And I feel like bringing that back a little bit is just, you know, by the way, the cell phone today has come a long way. Like I turned the volume up and that didn't clip. It actually, you know, it has, you know, limited, right? Yep. So it didn't clip. Like it was actually, the audio wasn't bad. So I'm going to start doing a little bit of that because in my free time, I'm always plugging into something. And if I could ask my son, hey, just hold this phone up. Let me just get that 3 minute clip.
Absolutely throw it up. I mean, it's something that if any one of us can use to just say, hey, that's really cool, that's what I like, that's better than not having it up there, my opinion.
Yeah. So with that said, I'm going to release something right now. I'm going to just title it real quick. Do you think I should title these sort of like cell phone clip videos?
As far as what, just put whatever you're playing, whatever you're doing. What's it for?
This was the PV Windsor. I just did it earlier. Let's do this. I'm gonna release it right now. And I just published it. PV Windsor Studio Review, cell phone video review.
There you go.
So if you check, you will have, if you are subscribed to my channel, you would see that I just released a cell phone video review of the PV Windsor Studio. And I'll tell you what, man, that's like one of those amps that's not sitting behind me. And you could buy that amp for like $200-$300. And it just sounds great. It's a one trick pony, but watch the video. You'll see why I like it. I tell you why I like the amp. All right. I just released that. So yeah, you know, it's one of those, you know, how polished should it be? Right. You know what I mean? Cause some of the production is off the hook, right?
Yes. But again, you know, sometimes you don't get the true context of what that thing sounds like because you're hearing a lot of production value go into that. When you get sometimes it's a little different.
Yeah. Oh, so someone wrote cell phone quickie or gut check. I like cell phone quickie. That's kind of cool. Yeah. So, all right, let's see how it goes. If I get beat up in the comments, it may make me think twice, but so Blues Bunker wrote great video. Dan wrote, did I do the video with the Viper 100? Dan, I'm not following you. The video you did in my backyard with the Viper 100, did you use that as a head? No, that was actually the combo amp. Terry wrote, nothing wrong with doing short videos raw. You could maybe also seek out some folks to do raw videos like PGS used to do with Andy and Brett. Interesting.
MMC is saying it sounds decent enough. Keep doing it.
All right. Flipside in the house. What's going on, dude? So Evil Homer, I agree with you on the overproduction, which I have to be honest with you. That's always been, so my thing has always been, you know, what does an amp sound like if you plug it in? Because, you know, think about growing up, right? You know, you'd have George Lynch playing on docking and you're like, oh my God, that sounds amazing. And then you walk into 48th Street Music Store and pick up an ESP and you're like playing it through like whatever 1x12 combo amp that right there. It's like, this doesn't sound like docking, you know? What's the amp on top of the PV? That's a Night Train, a Vox Night Train. Can you guys still hear me? Why do I hear myself?
Is that me feeding back?
Testing. That's weird. I could throw up.
Yeah, I think it's Gizmos.
Testing. Nope, I still hear it. Gonna try to solve the echo. Testing. Oh, I think it went away. Testing.
Yeah, I put headphones on.
Oh, okay.
So let me do this.
Excuse me.
Testing. Can you talk? Can I hear you?
Yep.
Okay. Let me raise that volume a little bit more. One more time.
Check.
Okay, good. Okay, it's gone. So I did want to share some stuff with everyone. Oh, okay, so some of the comments are already coming in on that video. The cell phone. Cell phone quickie, I should call it. Okay, I'll update it later. But yeah, I was, you know, it's one of those things. I was just jamming out, sitting in my cozy chair, playing the Windsor. And It's funny, I called my son on his cell phone, like, can you come down just for a minute? He was like, yeah, I'll come down. Yeah, I'll record you. Not very fun for, you know. What did Terry write? You almost have a Steve from Boston vibe in that video. Huh, interesting. Okay. Well, you know what? I could probably, you know, like I said, anytime I'm not on camera, when I'm just kind of down here hanging out, I'm always plugging into something different. So there it is. All right. So let's change topics a little bit. I want to share two pieces of gear with everyone. One of them is this by Comica.
Oh, yeah.
And if anybody does like any sort of interview, this is the thing you want. Okay. So let me pop this open. Comica sent this over, which I am very thankful for. But even more than that, In the Blues hooked me up with them. And here's the backstory to that. So In the Blues was covering, Comica makes like pro audio stuff. And he was telling them that, you know, I do a lot of interviews and that type of thing. And they make this thing. So if you see this, and see if, well, hold on, let me get this out of here. So if you see this thing here, it's basically two lavs, right? Two transmitters and one receiver. So if you think about, like when I did the Paul Reed Smith interview this last weekend or whenever it was, you know, I put the lav on him since he was the one I was interviewing. Oh, Steve from Boston, what's up, dude? But it would have been cool since I was the one asking the questions if I was also lavved up. But the thing, you know, the problem is always having too many audio sources. That means more editing work to have to sync that audio. So this is one receiver, two transmitters, and it's, you know, single output into a cell phone, into a GoPro, whatever it may be. So you get both things. And that's that. And you don't have to fiddle with batteries because they're all USB chargeable, you know, internal lithium ion, metal power packs. It's very Sennheiser look and feel. And this one here, this is one of the transmitters. And here's your receiver. So check this out. The receiver is recording on two channels. And you also have a headphone monitoring. So let's say, Gizmo, let's say you were holding the camera for the interview, right? Let's just say. You could do output into the GoPro, which is what I was using, and you could monitor that. So if you wanted to make sure things were working, make sure that, like in the factory, that the background noise wasn't overpowering, you know, what the lav was picking up, you could actually monitor that. So like full featured, how cool is that?
It's very cool.
You don't have to fiddle with batteries. You just obviously need to make sure everything's charged up in advance. One goes on the camera, one on me, one on the person I'm interviewing. That's it. That's the rig. Yeah, so Un-Effin' Believable says, how long do the transmitters last? That's a good question. I want to assume they last long enough. I'm pretty good with batteries in terms of I don't let things run all day. I turn them off when I should be turning them off. So there it is. Steve, if you want, I could send you the link if you want to come on and chat a little bit. Let me know. I'm happy to send that link over to you. Let me put that down. But that's a score. And again, I want to thank Comica for sending that out. And you know what the best thing about that is? It's a company like this that understands what I do, and they are not necessarily sending me something because they need the press and the promo. That's not what this is about. This was, hey, we make something that you could use that will help you make a better video. And I appreciate that. So, you know, I would say, you know, give them a look, see what they have. You know, the least I could do for them in return is tell you about them and how kind they were and all that stuff. So do be sure to check out what they have going on. In fact, you could see how the receiver looks with the camera and the headphone and then the two lavs on that. You could also get this with one lav and one microphone. And they asked me, they were like, do you want the microphone? I'm like, no microphone. the less I have in my hand, the better off I am. So if you kind of take the microphone picture away, that's what I have. That's what the hookup looks like, you know, which is really cool. So
what do you think? On that one?
What was that?
What was the cost on that one?
That's a good question. I think so they sent me that. So there was no cost to me for that, just to be transparent here. With that said, the street cost of that is, I think, $300, $200. If somebody could look it up, I'd be grateful. What's really important to know is that the Sony version of that, because not everybody, thank you, Kevin, totally, it's an awesome setup. The
$389.
How much?
$389.
Not everybody makes a double receiver that could talk to two transmitters. Sony makes one and it's like $800. So it's literally half the price of the one that I'm aware of that has. In fact, that's why I bought this. No. The Sony is $1,200. And again, if somebody could look that up, I would appreciate that. Because when I bought my Sennheiser, which is what I did all my interviews on, I spent $800 on the Sennheiser single, you know, transmitter receiver. $800 was on the cheap because the double from Sony was $1,200 or $1,100, something like that. So the fact that that gives me two transmitters, one receiver for, you know, street price of less than $400 is awesome. So if you do that sort of thing, I would check it out.
The Sony on the cheap looks like it's $799. It's $800.
$800 for the two transmitters? One receiver?
No. $1,200.
There it is. $1,200. The price hasn't budged either. And okay. I got my Sennheiser, one of those, you know, 20% coupons. So I got like mine was about $600. But when you think about what it is, $600 is still a lot of money for, you know, a little microphone, right?
Yeah.
But So Steve from Boston, would you like to hop on? Would you like to join If you'd like to, let me know and I'll send you the link. While I'm waiting for that, the other thing I wanted to share with everyone was the Rode Bass. Oh, thank you, Phil, for sending him the link to the stream. Thank you, Phil. So the Rode Bass, which I'm going to unbox right now, you know, it's interesting because it's no joke. I got it right here. The Rode tuner is awesome. Okay. If you've never tried this, you should. So the bass will also do a bass guitar, but it will, you know, because the motor is stronger or bigger or whatever it is, and guitar and the regular electric guitar. So this is brand new. Nicest bunch of people as well. I saw them at a Winter NAMM and they had my video playing on like this reel, which was pretty funny seeing me in a video at Winter NAMM.
Steve says he can't jump on.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. Oh, wow. This one is a little bigger. Actually, I'll give you a size comparison here. There you go.
Wow.
And that's actually nice because the, let's see if we got battery here. There we go. I just powered that on and it's on the front. Add instrument. So bass guitar, acoustic, electric, what does that one say? Classical, uke, concert uke, tenor uke, baritone uke, mandolin, banjo. So those are all the different things it could do.
And if I go to electric guitar, I click on electric guitar. Then I have six string. Let's see if I could do it like that. Six string, seven, 12. There you go.
That's very cool.
Yeah. And then if I hold down the button, it should turn it off. There it is. Actually, I think I like this one here is a little different. This is the guitar tuner. And if I hold that up, it's right on the top. And same type of thing. If I click electric guitar, what did I just do? Exit tuning. Yeah. So this is, you know, this will go through the different, you know, the different tuning, and then you just press the button and it tunes it, which is, this was brilliant. In terms of gadgets, I have to tell you, this was a cool gadget.
What's the price point on the bigger one?
I don't know. They sent this over also. Can someone look that up and let me know what that is so I could share that with you? But these are really cool.
The base one looks like it's $149.
Yep. So you know what I think, you know, during the holidays, like, you know what I think? Everyone always gets into the debate, and we could talk about the debate, right? Do you really want a robot tuning your instrument? And, you know, Gibson had this, right? It was one of the big problems with Gibson, right? But here's what's interesting. So yeah, when you're just tuning up and you want to put a like $10 clip on the, you know, the back of your headstock, that's okay. I get that. But what's really cool about this, if you want to tune to open A, what I would have to do is, or open D or open G or whatever it is, I'd have to go to Google. I'd type it in. I'd have to figure out what each string is supposed to be. So like for alternate tunings, it's brilliant, right? And I think that's where I started using this a lot. Like if you wanted to do slide and an open tuning, you put this on the headstock, you just scroll to it, you select it, open D, whatever it is, hit the button and it tunes it. Done. Which is brilliant.
Let me get a little controversial. That's cool.
Yeah.
Then why weren't the machine heads on the back of Gibson such a hit? They're the ones that did the automatic tuning.
You want my humble opinion?
Yeah.
I think that let's open that question up to everybody. Why did nobody want robot tuning, the Tronical on Gibson? I think the answer is they wanted a traditional guitar without the tech. That's what I think.
That's where I was going with that. I think you're absolutely right with that. But if the product is a good product, which I did hear that there were some issues with those tuners.
Yes.
But with if it's a good product.
Yep.
Will
Smith just said, because it's attached to the guitar.
Right.
Yeah, I'd agree.
You know what? I don't think anyone wants to spend $300. What did I just say? $3,000 to have this big hunk of plastic attached to the back of a headstock.
Exactly.
You know. And I have to tell you, one time, this was back in 2013, maybe, I went into a music store, I wanted to try it, and I couldn't even figure it out. It was like, what am I doing here? How do you make it where this, when I did the unboxing of this, I unboxed it, I didn't open a manual, I scrolled to it, and it just worked. Life was good, you know. The Gibson thing, it was like I was pulling, just wasn't working, you know.
So ease of use.
Yep. But you know what? Like for instance, this in my opinion is like a perfect gift. Let me tell you why. Right. And I see it. My kids aren't into guitars, but my kids are into other things. So what's that new Nintendo now? That new Nintendo game they have, the Switch. So all three of my kids wanted the Switch. So of course, they were getting, you know, I had two birthdays this month, my two boys' birthdays of this month. So my daughter's graduation. So they all got Switch games and controllers and bags and all that stuff. So when you think I'm hearing myself again and it went away. So when you think about the money that goes into when you're buying a gift for that thing that your kid or your husband or your boyfriend or your girlfriend, whatever, is interested in, you know, that's the price point of one of these. Right. So if you wanted to, you know, give your guitar loving kid, husband, whatever it is, a cool gift, this is the gift. This is it. Because what else are you buying him? A strap?
Right.
You know, I think the problem with some of the, like a strap as an example, is you might buy him a pattern that they don't like. But this is kind of cool, in my very humble opinion.
Agreed. You know?
I think it's a
little gadget.
It's a gadget. Yeah. It's a gadget. Throw it in your case, fiddle with alternate tunings, you know.
I think that's where that really accelerates, is with the alternate tunings.
Absolutely.
Because if you want to take your guitar from, you know, standard to, you know, open G or something like that, in a matter of seconds, you just hit it and go and it's there.
Yep. Yep. I agree. And, you know, the other day I was listening to Stone Roses, Love Spreads, and I think that's open A. And again, I don't know what the alternate tuning is. I would have had to go to Google, and I just put this on open A, tuned it, and boom, I was right there. It was like easy breezy. This is cool because it does bass. That was always, I thought that the biggest drawback of this was it just does the guitar. This does the guitar and the bass. So I would have to say, given a choice, I'd get this one, you know. And just to give you size perspective, well, here's a can of soda. You know, it's about half the, you know, 3/4 of the size of a can of soda, you know, relatively thin, you know. And it seems very well made.
Pretty good time saver, especially if you're changing tunings, playing a gig or something like that. Be able to hit it really quick in between songs or during a breakdown.
Yep. So that's that. You know, they had, I think they originally launched, Rhodey launched, I think it was a Kickstarter. I think it was a Kickstarter campaign that they did. And they crushed it. And it's funny because when they very first came out, the Kickstarter was great, but I think, and maybe I'm thinking of something else, but I think you had to have the iPhone open, like the very first version of this. So you put this on the guitar, right, but you had to control it on the iPhone. And it's funny, that Kickstarter did really well. However, people said, I don't want to be tied to the phone. Right. And that's when they incorporated everything without the phone into here, which was brilliant. And, you know, I have to tell you, I'm pretty hard on things. If I don't like it, I don't deal with it, period. And this thing is sitting right on my desk. I use it all the time. I use it all the time, you know. I don't own a Peterson. I know Petersons are great tuners. For small tuners, you know, these little poly tunes are pretty good.
I mean, I would say the only time you need something that is accurate as a Peterson is if you're doing your own setups.
Yep. Yep.
I mean, Petersons are great tuners, but
doesn't the Strobo Plus also like a DI box or something like that?
Not sure on that. I know they make a mini, that's the mini version, right? That's the pedal.
Yep. The pedal.
Yep.
So what else is news? Let's change the, so those are the two pieces of gear I wanted to show. I think did everyone already see did I show the new single cut on my last live show, or was that on the Patreon show? I don't even remember. Did I show that?
Yeah, you showed that in the last live show.
Okay.
The PRS, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So everyone got to see that. So I think everybody's pretty much up to date with everything that I have over here. And that's it. Did Slash buy BC Rich? Not yet. Not yet.
So you're putting in your bid this week?
Not this week. You know, he just had a divorce. Did everyone see there was just a divorce? So apparently there was a divorce of sorts, and I don't know how that affects the rumor of him buying BC Rich guitars, but you know, the rumor is out there. Remember the $6 pitch pipes? I never had one of those. You don't mind seeing the PRS again? Just saying. Am I getting a Mayer PRS Strat? Probably not.
Well, we saw enough of them.
So, oh, revenge. Thank you, dude. Thank you. Thank you. This is why I love my string through, love my Floyd guitars, but it's so much easier to change strings and tuning. Been watching vids for 2 years. Keep them going. Thank you. Revenge 63901. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. So this was, this is the single cut, which I got for a crazy good deal. Oh yeah. Because I put the link of the place that I actually got this, and, I don't know. I just really like the way it looks. I wish it had birds, but it doesn't have birds.
I was going to say, the only thing that can make that better is if it had birds on it.
I know.
But it's still.
You know, there are, correct me if I'm wrong, there are SE guitars that are a grand, yes?
I don't know if they're close.
What's the most expensive SE guitar you could buy?
I believe it's an Artist. Is the Mark Holcomb?
Yeah, I think it's that one.
Yeah. I think the Holcomb comes in at like eight and a half, nine.
Wow. So almost a grand. It's a lot of money. Yeah. It's, well, you know what? They're creeping up, you know, a good imported guitar could run up to a grand, right?
Yeah. Well, and that's, you were talking about that before. I think, you know, we talk about guitar being dead.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's even close. I mean, you look at how many guitars are being produced, how many being bought, every market, every price point. I mean, you could buy guitars for, you know, $100, $150 all the way up to, you know, sky's the limit. And there's people buying all across the spectrum. So how can you come up with a statement like guitar is dead when people are buying them up?
I agree. The latest with the cutaway is 800 on AMS. Hmm. What was the comment about Doug Marks? I see Dripping Glass says Doug Marks, but I don't know what you're referring to. Remember Doug Marks, Metal Method, when we were growing up?
Oh, yeah. I still got those VHSs.
I think I have them somewhere. He's got a YouTube channel now.
Yep.
I actually left a comment on one of his videos. I don't remember but he replied. I'm like, wow, this is like a guy that like had like the best like lessons, right? He advertised those lessons like crazy. He probably made a lot of money as well.
Oh yeah.
And Kevin paid $1,200 for the Gibson Thunderbird 4 years ago. Yeah, I mean, I think you could get a USA-made guitar for the, you know, that $1,000 price point. I think the best time to buy a Gibson is at the end of the year also. They treat it like cars, right? It's like going to a car dealership at the end of the month, end of the quarter, end of the year. The deals Absolutely. Just keep getting better.
Yeah. Especially if it's been sitting on the showroom a little bit.
That was this. This was a 2016, which I almost wondered, did I get it at cost, below cost? I don't know. This
you
was
got a good deal on it.
$750 shipped.
Got a good deal on it.
No, which is, and this is an S2. So I don't know. I like it. There's one more on Reverb. If you want to snag it, it's out there. But Kevin's got the TTK1 BC Rich. Awesome, dude. I forgot about that. I forgot that you got one of those. I have mine hanging right up over there. What a great guitar. So, what else is new? What's trending? What do you think, Jason Gizmo? Anything trending? Any new news out there? Worth talking about?
That's the question. Yeah. We're talking about
So NAMM, Summer NAMM's around the corner. I haven't really seen much by way of new stuff. I know the new Fender Mexican series is out.
Yes.
Right? So that's new news.
Which is getting pretty good reviews.
Yeah, so that's one of the things I'm actually going to check out at Chuck Levin's is the, you know, the new, what is it called? The Player Series?
Player Series.
Yes, yeah. Player Series.
The Player Series. So let me look up something real quick. So there's a Jaguar, a Jazz, a Tele, and a Strat, right? Just those four in the Player Series, or am I missing one?
Yeah, I think you're right.
I believe that's it.
Got you. And I think Chuck's has all four of those, so I want to check those out. And Gibson apparently leaked the 2019 lineup. Did everyone hear about that?
No.
So apparently it hit their website, the 2019, and then it was only up for 2 hours, and then it came down.
Oh, somebody hit publish when they weren't supposed to, huh?
Or maybe it was planned.
Yeah.
That's what we're trying to figure out, you know.
Question is there anything on there that was revolutionary or?
I don't know. I didn't see it. I know Phil saw it. I think Phil got a screenshot of it.
But then there's that whole debate. Do you really want your Les Paul to look different? Do you want Gibson to come out with something different? Or do you want to see just quality SGs and Les Pauls and Explorers? And I think the key word there is quality.
Right. Oh, so did Phil already do the review on it? I know he was telling me he was working on a video.
He did the Strat Player Series.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, gotcha. Yeah, better pickups, better electronics. So, yeah. So we got some bass players in the house. So, Kevin, I'm curious. Are you still jamming? Do you doing anything with the bass? So, Kevin and I, we actually have jammed a few times. We were actually in a band together, dude, if you remember. Well, I know you remember, but I was in a band with Kevin, we had a lot of fun. Dude, I'm going to call you on Monday. Catch up. It's been a while. Steve from Boston. I almost never buy a new guitar, maybe three or four. Huh. Yeah, you know. Yep, I will. I'll tell you, you know, some of the guitars that are even listed as used, like that PRS was listed as used, but it wasn't a used guitar. Sometimes companies will mark things as used to skirt around MAP prices, minimum advertised price, all that. So sometimes you could get a really good deal. You just need to read between the lines a little bit on that, you know. I know Guitar Center does that. Some retailers will do that, you know. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't know how many people are paying full pop for instruments. There's so many ways to get a deal. In fact, that's one of the videos I'm going to do is, you know, like five ways you could always get a deal on a guitar. I just need to do it. I know I said it on my last live show, but I'll need to do that. So yeah, any news from Diamond? That's a good question. I invited Jeff. Let me see if I could get him on here. Hang on one second. All right, just ping him to see if he could come on. And everybody absolutely wants a deal. That's a fact. So I just pinged Jeff Diamond. Let's see if Jeff wants to come on. And he could give us the latest and greatest on what's going on with Diamond. And, but I think that's all
what
I
have. You had your best experience as far as selling gear? Because, I mean, I know everybody looks for the fire sale, you know, the best deal, we all do as far as that goes.
Yeah, selling gear is a different story. I'm a lot better at buying it than I am at selling it, obviously.
Yeah.
Selling gear is tough because, like Craigslist, I've sold a few things on Craigslist, and of, let's say, 10 things I've sold, maybe I had one positive experience. Flip side, that is true. That is true. So I think that I've had good luck selling stuff on eBay. I've had decent luck selling stuff on Reverb. I've had decent luck selling stuff privately to people that I know. But the stuff to people I know, you know, there's different ways in which you could sell something. So I'll give you an example. I had an Ibanez DT350, dead mint condition. It was truly a closet classic from like 1984 or 1985. In fact, I used it in an old video of mine. And I never, I love the guitar. I truly never played it. And it wasn't the destroyer that I wanted. So I didn't want the guitar. Now, I could have sold it to a buddy for, you know, $500, but I didn't want to sell it to a buddy for $500. I wanted like $1,200 for that guitar, right? Because it was, so that was not a guitar I was willing to give a deal, because it was like new from 1985 or 1986, whatever it was, dead mint condition. And I figured the person that's going to buy that guitar is somebody that had that growing up, that's willing to pay top dollar for the guitar that they had growing up. And I was 100% right, because somebody saw it. They said, I want that. It was the guitar I had growing up. And they were actually local, came to my house, paid me cash on the spot, bought the guitar. Life was good. That person was thrilled, and I was thrilled because I got good money on that guitar. Now, stuff that is not rare or discontinued, I will sell to a deal all day long to someone I know as a first thing, right? And I've done that. I've had some amps, some guitars. And if I could, if it's not like a rare piece, I'd give a deal to anyone I know. And I've done that to some folks on Patreon, you know who you are, to some folks locally, so on and so forth. I've always given like a really good deal, you know, if I could, especially some retailers out there. Like if I have a bunch of stuff, I could put as much stuff in a box and just give them, you know, that person a really good deal. I'll do that. So that's number two. And then you get into stuff that, you know, like for instance, I had a BC Rich Warlock with blood on it. Right. So that's, you know, I don't really have any friends that want that for a deal. Right. And it's not super rare. So you just put it on a Reverb or an eBay and you got to let it bake. You got to find the guy or the gal that wants, you know, to pay the asking price for that guitar. So there's a couple of, depending on what it is, there's a couple of different ways to sell a piece of gear. That's the thing.
Yeah, that's the hardest thing though. When you've made the decision that you just want to get rid of it, you gotta just wait for that right person to come along. It's the best way, but it's hard.
It is hard. It's like, you know, when I put a piece of gear on Reverb or eBay, I think of it like throwing a fishing line in the water.
Yeah.
You got to wait. It's never, I remember when eBay first started, it was, you put something on, it sold instantly. Now I'll put something on and it'll sell 3 months later, which is crazy. But if it's current, you know, like, and I don't want to name specific pieces of gear, but you know, if there's something current, something hot, something trending, and I have it that, and I don't want it, you know, I'll ask some people I know, hey, you interested in this? I'll give you a great deal. And, usually the answer is yeah. And that person's thrilled. I'm thrilled. And you know, you just get to pay it forward to somebody else. Right. So, you know, that's the easy way to do it. But unfortunately, it's not always that easy. You know, Phil says the only downside, it takes more time to get the money to buy something, but at least no hassle about selling. Here's what I wouldn't do. I wouldn't go to Guitar Center and sell something to Guitar Center. Let's put it like that. That would be at the bottom of my list. Steve says it's a buyer's market. May more product than consumers right now. Yeah. It's a good point. Here's a true story. I still have the guitars, and I, you know, later decided I didn't want to sell them, but I have an ESP, not an LTD, an ESP Strat and Tele set. Swamp Ash body, gorgeous guitars. And these are the original Vintage Plus series guitars. I've been offered $3,000 for the set, and that's probably the right price for the set. Before I was offered $3,000, I turned that down. When I thought I wanted to sell it, I brought those two guitars into a guitar center. This is probably going back 10 years ago. And 10 years ago, they were probably worth $1,200 a piece, something like that. So 24 for the set. So I brought it into a guitar center. And they were like, yeah, we'll give you like $250 a piece. I'm like, are you crazy? And they're like, well, you know, we'll sell it for $500 a piece and it'll move tomorrow. I'm like, yeah, it'll move tomorrow. Because, you know, and you know, the guy said, listen, you know, we're not trying to make a killing on the stuff. We need to move the stuff.
Yeah.
I'm like, ugh. So yeah, after that, I would never sell something to Guitar Center because I'm not into, pennies on the dollar. I was in a Guitar Center one time, and some dude who looked like he needed the cash had like a JCM. Oh no, maybe it was a JCM 2000 amp head. It looked dead mint. Who knows? You know, but it looked like the condition was outstanding. And he asked I was standing waiting online to talk to the guy behind the counter, and the guy at Guitar Center was like, "Yeah, I'll give you like $250 for that." And my jaw hit the floor, and I said, and he walked out, you know, the guy from Guitar Center, and I'm like, dude, why would you sell that for $250? He was like, I need the money. I'm like, oh man. I told him, I said, if I was in the market, I need another Marshall head. Like I need a hole in my head, but I'm like,
here's $300. Here you go.
I was just like, dude, $250 for a British made Marshall amp. It's like, but that's Guitar Center. Cause Guitar Center will, you know, they'll buy that for $250. They'll put it up for $600 and it'll go.
Yep.
You know, Steve says that's pretty standard. Pay 40 to 50% of what you're planning to sell it for.
Absolutely.
You know, that's crazy.
Yeah, they'll give you half of what they're going to sell it for.
You know what? I think unless you absolutely positively need the money right then and there. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, Snaposaurus says the tubes alone cost $250. If you absolutely need the money right then and there, I guess go to Guitar Center. But before I ever did that, I'd probably put it on Reverb for $400, you know, that type of thing.
I think that's one of the great things about Reverb is, you know, not to give a plug or anything, but you had eBay before that you were surfing.
They're awesome. Plug away.
You were surfing through eBay, you know, just trying to find stuff. And now you have a community Reverb that's just all music stuff. So you want to go on there. You're looking up stuff. You don't have to sort through, you know, you put JCM 2000 on there. You don't have to search through 400 things that are labeled as JCM 2000. You just find what you're looking for and buy it.
Yep. Yeah. So, you know, if I want something to go, I'll throw another fishing, you know, reel out there and, you know, somebody will get it. But before I usually do that, I would ask around to some, you know, people that I know, and sometimes half the time, you know, I could usually make something, you know, put something in someone's hands for a good price, you know, because I'm not really like that Ibanez guitar I was explaining to you. I wanted top dollar for that. That was a closet classic, right? And I have a few of those, right? I have a few of those style guitars. But, you know, something that's not a closet classic. Yeah, if I could let it go to someone at a good price, I would do that. Where did Steve get the wrench? I want one too. So he's a moderator. So he has the wrench because he's a moderator. And it's really just to moderate. So revenge. Hang on. There you go. You're a moderator. Keep it clean and healthy. Keep the chat clean and healthy. So if you leave a chat, you'll see the wrench there. So let's see what else. CME. What's CME? CME was great with the Gibson sale. I paid $2,300 for a blonde figured 175 that Dave has for $450. I don't know what that is. Sharifin from Malaysia. What's going on, man? You know, I haven't really done a killer deal in a long time. I have to be honest with you. I'm not seeing too many killer deals. You know? Oh, Chicago Music Exchange. Okay. Like a killer deal for me is when, like, for instance, when we were selling those diamond guitars for $200 a piece and they had a set of EMGs, that's a killer deal. Even like the S2, I know I got a good deal for $750, but I don't know if that's a killer deal. It's still a lot of money for a guitar. You know, I don't know. I haven't seen a killer deal in a long time. Am I wrong? Like, has anyone seen? I remember the Bugera amp heads were selling for like $250 a piece or $200 a piece. I did a killer deal on them. I did a killer deal on BC Rich guitars for like $300 a piece with EMGs. Like, yeah, diamond guitars shipping $200 shipped to Europe. I mean, you know, we did some really good deals, but I don't know. I feel like it's leveled out a little bit, you know? Everything is great. Your video is the only right time for me streaming live. Thanks. Oh, thank you. The spine splitter. Got a quick question. Need a foot switch to power on and off the reverb in my SS70? I have no idea. So, anyway, that's all I have right now.
Do you want to tackle that NAM?
Do I think the GR55 ever took off? What was the GR55? Oh, why don't I think the GR55 ever took off? I don't know. What's the GR55?
I don't know.
When was the last time anyone offered a coupon higher than 20%?
Oh, is that the Roland GR55?
Oh, I don't know.
That's a guitar synth.
I don't know. I don't know.
I can tell you I had one. I can tell you why it didn't take off. it again, it's a button mash. You know, you're trying to figure out how to use it. It wasn't very, I don't want to say it wasn't intuitive, but it, you know, unless that was your thing, it wasn't something you were just going to work into a set.
Right.
Unless you're, you know,
Stevens.
Yeah. Or Living Color when they're using them. I mean, they, you know, other than that, I don't know.
Yep. So James Shackelford, first of all, thank you very much. You wrote, who is Vinnie Paul Abbott? Apparently he died yesterday. So Vinnie Paul was first of all, he was Dimebag's brother. Okay.
Yes.
And he was also the drummer to Pantera. And the drummer to, somebody help
me
out here.
Damage Plan.
Thank you. Damage Plan.
And also, what's his latest project? I can't think of it right now.
Yep. Oh, Hell Yeah. He was also in Hell Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Yep. So. Hey, Flipside, we need to catch up also soon, dude. Be nice to catch up. Terry wrote, guitar synth isn't us a big thing. You can do most stuff pedals. So, you know what's interesting? I watched, I know a lot of people love Rig Rundowns. I'm not a huge fan. I don't know. I know everyone, I'm not even going to tell you why I'm not a huge fan. I don't know why I'm not a huge fan. It's just, I don't watch a lot of YouTube videos. I know that's crazy, but I've said that before. Usually when I'm watching YouTube videos, it's like science or history or, you know, a quick adrenaline shot of some comedy. But outside of that, but the Rig Rundown that I recently watched that I really enjoyed was Steve Stevens. And man, was I impressed. Like, first of all, Steve Stevens, I think he's an underrated guitar player. He's really good. He did a video where I forget what he was promoting, but he wailed on the guitar, right? And he did his rig rundown, and he has MIDI controllers that's doing like synth sounds. He's really in, really in tune with every moving part. I know a lot of the rig rundowns, they have like the guitar techs. Like, this guy had full command over everything that was going on with his rig, right? I use these cabinets and these heads and these pickups, and here's why I do this, and these are the wireless units. But the thing that was most impressive was he had this board, and he's like, when I'm playing the intro to this song, I put this pedal down, and then I get the string section for this, and then I pull that back. It's like, he's doing all the tap dancing himself. That was really impressive. Yeah, no reason why I don't like rig rundowns. I don't know. I guess it's not that I don't like them. I just don't watch them. But the Steve Stevens one, man, was just was awesome. Kubrick says you love the fact that Guitar Center allows you to test out equipment. Well, the other problem with Guitar Center is they don't really have all the stuff, right? I feel like there's a lot more gear out there that is interesting that they don't, you know, they don't have a lot of, like, you can't play a boogie at Guitar Center, right? You know,
no, they've pulled back on the stuff that they have too.
Yeah. They're really going towards lessons.
Yeah.
Steve from Boston says Steve Stevens is like a race car driver that knows every inch of his rig. Absolutely. Like, I'm telling you, that impressed me. That was really, really impressive. So check that one out if you're interested.
Yeah, it's funny. I just watched a rig rundown, and the guitar player the whole time is asking the tech, what is this? What model is this? How does this work? How does this go?
So what do you mean? Who was saying what?
The rig rundown that I just watched,
okay,
was it was pretty interesting because the guitar player, they were interviewing him, and it was for what was it for? Oh, Justin Timberlake's drummer. I mean, a guitar player. Sorry.
Okay.
And the whole time he was asking the tech. He's like, "What model is this? How does this work? How does this?" Yeah. He had no idea. He just gets up there and plays. And it was interesting. Steve Stevens just knows every bit of everything. He knew
it cold. And I thought it was great. I need to watch more of those. You know, I need to watch more of those.
They are a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's good to see what other people are doing and how creative they get with some of the stuff.
Did you get a chance to watch that Hired Guns that Gizmo brought up?
I did not. I want to. I just didn't get there yet.
Yeah, that's a good view, man. I liked it.
Yeah, if you guys haven't seen that, that is definitely worth watching. Hired Guns. See that?
Black Corvo, new tube amp, new video. Hey, Black Corvo, if you don't mind, first of all, thank you for the super chat. If you don't mind, can you email me that link so I could watch it offline? I'd appreciate that. So thank you. But thank you for sharing that. Dude, I get it. So I don't know if everyone knows this, but Black Corvo builds amps. And he's always sending me like little video snippets of like what he's doing. Dude, you got to send me one day so I could show everyone exactly what you're doing. Or you just share your videos, something like that. But
absolutely.
Snapsaur says a lot of guys are heavy into branding their own gear now. Like what? What do you mean by that? What do you guys think he means by that? Let me just go through.
What was the comment
about players like branding their own gear now? A lot of guys are heavy into branding their own gear now. Does he mean like Steve Stevens with the signature stuff? Is that kind of what you mean?
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Black Corvo, did you email while I'm on the show, or did I miss an email from earlier? Because while on the show, I'll watch it tomorrow.
Oh, somebody's saying like Zach Wild and Wild Audio.
Mm, got it. John Mayer's PRS Sam. Steve I has his own.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think there's a business side to some of it. You know, there's a royalty deal with that sort of thing. You know, I think signature gear is I think there's a, you know, an income aspect to it for musicians. You know, if there, and I don't know what it is, but let's just say for every Wild Audio guitar that gets sold, you know, Zach Wild's making money, right?
Did you hear that Zach's playing for Ozzy again?
I did.
And that's he's being a little healthier too. Dropped a little bit of weight.
Really? Well, that's good. I know he stopped drinking.
Yeah, I think that's what happened. He lost to keep up on stage now.
Slash is front and center on BC Rich's website. Huh? Let me take a quick peek at that. Last time I looked at BC Rich website, it was 2007 models are coming soon. Maybe they updated it. I don't see him front and center over here. Am I missing it? I see the Kerry King.
Oh, there it is. Slash. Custom shop BC Rich. Bitch.
Why am I not seeing that? I'm on the BC Rich website.
It's flipping through. It started off with Kerry King and then it went to Slash after that.
I see the Forged in Fire Mach 5 Series Warlock. The MK3 Series War Beast.
This is the official BC Rich customshop.com.
Oh, okay. Hold on. BC Rich. Let's see what we have here. Okay, there's Kerry King.
You have to wait a second. I'll scroll.
Yep. There he is. The BC Rich Custom Shop itch. Interesting. It's funny because I always thought he was more of a Mockingbird guy than a bitch guy. Oh, and look who it is. It's Ron Estrada building the guitar. So Ron is the guy that built my snakeskin that I bought not this past winter at NAMM, but the year before. Interesting. Very interesting. Huh. Why do they have separate websites? Official BC Rich Custom Shop versus BC Rich Guitars.
This is the USA site. I don't know why. I would think it would be one.
Do they have what's in stock? Oh, let's see. Stock. I'm not seeing anything in stock. If I click on stock, nothing happens.
Same.
Interesting, though. Interesting. So I would show you the snakeskin, but I have it upstairs, so that's not going to happen at the moment. But, all right, folks, I think I'm going to wrap up. How long are we on here? What did we start about 10, I don't know, 20 after 10, about an hour and a half. So that's all I have. And it was certainly nice hanging out.
Absolutely.
So Gizmo and Jason, if you want to stay on a little bit after I end the broadcast. But thanks, everyone. Thanks for the super chats. I really appreciate it. It was very kind. And just a goodbye to everyone. I hope everyone has a great week. Stay tuned. I still have a lot more of the PRS factory videos. That's coming. And I'll be at Chuck's on Monday night. So that's coming. And maybe some more iPhone video reviews because I kind of enjoy that. It was quick, easy, and you got to see what I was playing right then and there. So have a great night, everyone. Evil Homer, Great Vanzini, Tonosaurus, Kubrick, Nice Guy Eddie, Mad Raj, Pacifica, Phil Smith, thank you, dude. I appreciate it as always. And Jason, Gizmo, thanks for hanging out. Steve from Boston, have a good one. Terry, thanks as always, buddy. Watchman for you. Uneffing believable. Gotta love the name. That name is uneffing believable. Dale Palmer, Dan Avenger, and everyone else. If I missed you, I'm sorry. Ed Axeman, Ron Padgett, and company. So thanks, everyone. Have a great night. I'll leave you all off with one of those bad boys right there. Thank you. Rock on. And we'll see you later. And JC Smith, thank you, dude, for the notes. So the stats came from JC Smith. Love that. So thanks, everyone. See ya.